One with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. You sing.
Now and forever, God. God, we look to you tonight. Above the singing, God, above the music, above the songs, let your name be lifted high, Jesus. Let your name be honored, God. And we commit all that we are to you, God, everything that we do, and we reach towards you.
Surrendering all and find.
that welcomed me. I was lost, but he brought me into his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, who is free. Jesus died for me. Yes, he died.
I'm a child. God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets form. If the stars were made to worship so loud, I can see your heart. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, oh God. So am I. God of your promise. Speak in vain, no syllable empty, oh boy. For once you have spoken, nature and science follow the sound of your voice. And as you speak,
ready? Okay. You all right?
Yeah.
Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we come to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, that you sent in this world, that through him we could have life and have it more abundantly. I come to you in his name as we ask your blessing on this service of thanksgiving for the life of Cynthia June Burke. I pray, God, that everything that would be done would be a means of glorifying Thee, and at the same time, those of us who are alive would somehow be exhorted, edified, enlightened, to be able to see ourselves in light of what we are doing today, this afternoon, in the light of death. I pray for the family, that Thou would give them strength and grace and wisdom and all that they would need during this time and the days afterwards. Thank You for the way Thou has kept them strong during the past days and months. And now, Lord God, it is into Your hand. We commit this service to You for Your honor and glory. I pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. We sing the first hymn, Through All the Changing Scenes of Life.
The changing scenes of life,
Yeah. Is it on? Yeah. Oh. Oh, you have. Okay, go ahead.
Good morning, church.
Gosh.
Scripture reading will be taken from Romans 8, 31 to 39. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall we lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, God, who also shall make intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulations, or distress, or persecutions, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for their sake, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yea, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Christ that love us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything other created shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
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 Him lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us. After which we will have a eulogy by Tanya Burke.
Good afternoon. Thank you. This eulogy will be done in the words of Faye herself, as it was an essay that she had written.
That's a good essay.
My name is Cynthia June Burke.
Let me read it for you.
I am 31 years of age. I am a Barbadian. I was born on the 21st day of June. I am 181 centimeters in height. I have no distinguishing marks. After reading this essay to you about myself, everyone here present will know something pertaining to my personal characteristics. Although it has been said that self-praise is no praise, I personally feel that in order for persons to be successful at whatever goal they aim to achieve in life, they must have the desire as well as confidence in themselves to do so. Sometimes no other person but yourself can succeed. In this way, self-praise is needed as a reward for your own efforts. Sometimes no one can give you the assurance you need. After working at a restaurant for several years, I decided I want to do something more and dedicate something more meaningful with my life. That is why I chose this course. And this was a nursing course. For those of you who didn't know that Faye did nursing. To be kind, you must be patient and emotional. I have the tendency to be both. It does not matter to me what race or creed a person may descend from. We are all human in the sight of God. I believe at some point in time, we will be needed to be nurtured by someone. Being a mother of one handsome son, I can proudly say that it is at that time when my caring experience began. I learned to be gentle and patient as well as understanding. Family is very important to me also. I love my family. Respect begins with the parent or guardian of each person. There are seldom any person who can relate to their family but can't relate to anyone else. I firmly believe that charity begins at home. Spirituality is of great importance to me. Although I may not attend church as regular as I should, I recognize God as my Savior. I will to help people in any way, place, whether in sickness or in giving advice. I know it is always best to ask God to guide you in any situation. There are times when I get depressed and frustrated, when certain events in my life seem to go wrong. I know that problems are a part of everyday life and I am not alone. I regain my courage and strength. Although I have a serious approach towards any goal I want to achieve, I never allow myself to be egocentric. There is always new knowledge to be gained each day, and I never see myself as knowing too much. Most importantly, I want people to know that despite my nonsense attitude, I am very approachable and always willing to lend a helping hand as long as I am able to do so. Adding to that myself, I will say, and I'm sure many of you will agree, Faye was selfless. She seldom said no. She was always willing and she was always helpful. And talk about punctual. If Faye had a 10 o'clock appointment, she would be bathed, dressed, and ready in the living room by 4 a.m.
Boy.
Faye loved children and was blessed with her first and only grandchild in December. Faye was soft-natured, kind-hearted, helpful,
and she loved to laugh.
If I stood here and gave the story of my life alone with Faye, we would never leave this church. Not to mention if I add the stories of her best friends, friends, and loved ones. Today, though we lay her body to rest, she will forever stay in our hearts because memories don't leave like people do.
Amen. Amen.
Our second scripture reading, St. Clair of Lourdes.
Good afternoon, church. The second scripture reading is from Revelation 21, verses 2 to 7. I saw a holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things have passed away. He was seated on the throne, said, 'I am making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.'" Here endeth the word.
Amen. On behalf of our church here, Grace Bible Church in Paddock Road, and our sister churches, we extend our deep condolences to Sister Burke, as we call her, and all her family. I've been praying for you and for Cynthia, and we will continue to do so, but we trust that in your grief, like listening to the eulogy, what she said is something that some people might not agree with. I mean, some denominations, let me put it that way. Me as an individual and as a church, I often say this. And she said, though she did not attend church often, yet she knew the Lord Jesus Christ as a Savior. And that is the important thing. A relationship with God. Now, I'm a pastor, and I like people... I would like to have as much people as this in church every Sunday, right? However, coming to this church or any other church, multiplied times, however, that does not make you able to say, "But I know I'm saved. I know I'm a Christian." Or church or pastor or priest or pope or creeds or rituals or any other thing. It's not what makes you a believer or to have the hope of eternal life after this life. It is by knowing a person called Jesus. And praise God, when I visited her, Cynthia, in the hospital, we had a discussion, and she assured me of that testimony that was read there. And expressed her knowledge and her feelings at that time. And so I thank the Lord that based upon that, we can say to the family, as Paul wrote in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, when he says concerning those who are dead, he said, "But we sorrow not as do others." And he was talking to a church where somebody came there and preached and told them, once you're dead, you're dead. And or once you're dead, there's no hope after that. Whatever happens after that, they don't know, but there's no hope for them. And Paul wrote what we call in 1 Thessalonians 4, starting from verse 13, what we refer to about the coming of the Lord Jesus. And he says, I'm writing this to give you assurance. I'm writing this so you wouldn't stay in what you heard, in your misunderstanding, or what those people told you as in relationship to what we told you. And he said that we sorrow not as do others, because the dead in Christ shall rise one day. And those of us who are alive shall not go before them, but all of us, when Jesus comes, those who are dead in Christ shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. And he goes on and says some other things, but the last verse of that chapter, he adds on this to all he says, wherefore, comfort one another with these words. And it is a blessing that we are able to come here and say that even though you're grieving, and rightly so, God made us that way. Some of us are differently made, I suppose, and we show our grief in different ways. Sometimes some people hold grief a long time and eventually have to go to get some counseling because they just hold it there. Some people are just able to departmentalize things and, you know, this is this and this is this and go on with their life. And sometimes some people misjudge them and say, well, how come this person so close to them, their family or whoever it is, died and they seem so cool, they don't show any grief? There are some people just like that. It's not that they're cold and hard-hearted. Maybe they are some people like that. But you can't judge them because there are some people who are able to... I wish that I was a person who could easily departmentalize something. Some people, when they leave work, from the time they walk out that door, that work done day. They go home, it's home. Whatever they're dealing with. Other people, they leave that door at work, they get in the car or wherever it is, and all they're thinking about is the work that happened, what happened there, and how we can get this due tomorrow. And work consumes their life. When they get home, they start to talk about that, and the children, they want to hear about work, or their husband or the spouse don't want to hear about work. And when they ain't listen, and they say, what you just said? Well, you ain't listening to me, you don't care, you know. And people bring the work home with them. We do that. Some people carry things with them, and some people just don't. And sometimes I wish I was able to departmentalize some things. However, there's grief in our life somehow, somewhere, and we handle it in different ways. However, when it comes to death, there is the reality of a separation. At moments in your life, you will think about that. And Paul is saying, one day you will see that person again. And therefore, I can say to the family and friends of Cynthia gathered here, that based upon her testimony, I could comfort you with these words, because of the promise of the Lord. Now, death is a mystery to those of us who are alive. Some people ask me when you know, questions, whether it's from the church or otherwise, about death and what happens after death. And I often tell them, well, I really never died yet. And I have a little, you know, curiosity about me and fantasy, and sometimes I tell the Lord, just for the sake of telling people with absolute assurance and everything else like that, I wonder if you let me die and let me come back and say this is how death is. But I suppose we've got people that won't believe me that happened anyhow. But death is a mystery. beyond while we're in this life. You might have your debates of what you think afterwards. Some people say, as we said, when you're dead, you're dead. When you die, you go there or you go here, or you roam about the place. Some people say that you turn out to be another creature. If you're a good person, you come back here on a higher level. If you're a bad person, you come back on a lower level, a lower human being, even a creature. Reincarnation. And so there's a mystery to it for those of us who are alive that we don't understand. However, it's a reality. The Bible tells us it's appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, the reward, or the place of reward. There's a reality of it, and some of us have been able to better handle the reality of death than others. Because of what's happening in the world, a lot of us are getting like kind of callous. And sometimes unless the thing hit real close to home, it don't really mean anything much to us. The first time that really struck me was when my 17-year-old nephew passed away suddenly. He was here at the church doing practicing for a Christmas program a Saturday evening. He left, went home, and when, I can't remember the time, but I got a call, I would say between 5 and 6, come to the hospital quickly. In those days, the casualty was different. It was inside of the old place where the casualty was. And when I went there and I saw my sisters and the others huddling together, and then I realized what happened. Immediately, it came to my mind, you know how many times I passed beside that casualty in the hospital and saw families there, saw people there crying in different ways, some hard, some and soft, and then and they're there in the sorrow, and I just passed by. It had no close connection to me, and I thought, that's a reality. But when it comes close to you, it's a different ball game altogether. But that's a reality of it. And sometimes, because of the reality of it, some people have become callous to it. And therefore, some people say, well, you can dead anyhow, so live as you like. Long ago, the Epicureans, or the Greek group, would say, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we might die. And so when Paul would preach to them about there is life after death, and he tried to prove it to them, and Wolf Revelation that was read, and the passage of scripture that I read coming in the procession, it talks about that there is life after death. And that was a big debate. And he tried to prove it through the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, his resurrection, and the fact that not only he testified of seeing him, but the fact that so many people saw him after his resurrection, that Jesus Christ is alive. And therefore, because of him, then death starts to lose a little of its mystery. It starts to make us think a little bit more as we get older about its reality and what about it. Now, when we were younger, I often say this in times like this, but I'm sure this happened to you. You're on the pasture running about on the beach or on the road, whatever, and you felt a little pain here when you're younger. And so death, yes, is also a very solemn. There are people who you might have visited yourself or might talk to at home, that on their dying bed, how they will look forward to dying. And in my years of ministry, I've seen this present with people who you went there feeling sorry for them, and you left there with a joyful spirit because how they're looking forward to one day they're leaving this body and they're going to meet the Lord. Now, for some of us, death, even though it might be a callous thing to some, it could be a very frightening thing for some. And there are some people who are very scared of it. Now, none of us really want to die. People say everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. I understand what they mean by that. But it's like, you don't really want to suffer. If you know what the Bible says about death. But then, who wants to suffer? And so you go to the doctor correctly. Or you take medication, you try to live as healthy as possible, and sometimes as long as possible. Sometimes people come to their place in life, they feel, you know, it's time for me to go. And so the psalmist, in the well-known psalmist we know, he gives an illustration of death, and he says, yea, though I walk through, and he called the word valley, and usually when we use the word valley, we think of something down, you know, we say we're down in the valley, and somebody up on the mountaintop. And he says, yes, though I walk through the valley, and then he says, of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. And when this first caught my attention, it became a blessing to me, still is, that he used the word shadow. And then one day I realized, you know, a shadow can't do nothing to you. It might jump you for a little while if a shadow passed, but it can't get a slap or hurt you or do anything. It's just a shadow. It passing. It's because there's some light somewhere. And he likens death. He says, the valley of dung it with death. Yea, though I walk through that valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And so in that state of what is a mystery to some, a reality to some, a callousness to some, something that's solemn to some, here to you, this is what I would like to convey to those of us who are alive, that yes, is appointed unto us once to die, and we don't know when that will be, but that we can look forward to death in a different manner and see that we could come to the place in our lives that God has made it possible to come to a place in our lives, not with being a brainwash and say, you know, brainwash and say, you know, after death is going to happen to them, and get you to believe that because you hear it over and over. But a reality of the scripture, of the word of God, when Paul wrote 1 Corinthians chapter 4, he started off and he put in there, I would not have you to be ignorant, he says, and I tell you this on the authority of the word of God, that this is what's going to happen. And through God's word, we have been given hope. We have been given an assurance that this event that man years ago, somebody came up with a little cartoon figure with a thing you reap with and his head down and some hat, and they call him the Grim Reaper, you know. And that's how some people see him, call him Grim Reaper. The Lord Jesus Christ came to change all of that, to give us a different outlook of death. And he says that he's a resurrection and the life. If any man believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. He says, I am come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And so, think of that. There is, though, very quickly, the positive side to death. And one of them is that God has made death to help to relieve us from pain and suffering. You know how difficult it's been for some people. They go and they see their loved ones in such great pain and suffering, and the doctor says we can't do nothing. And death, on a positive side, takes care of that for us. You can imagine living long, 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 and just you're living long, but you're having all these aches and pains. God's and pains, aches and pains. God has made a way out for us. But in making that way out for us from that pain and illness, he brings with it something that's so much better. The song said it, no more night. The scripture passage that was read said it, no more crying, no more dying. There will be a new heaven and a new earth. The scripture tells us that in the book of 1 Corinthians 15, that one day this mortal shall put on immortality, this corruption shall put on corruption, and we shall be able to look at death and say, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? That we can look back and say, death, where is thy mystery? Death, where is the sorrow you brought? Death, where is the fear that you brought in me? It's gone because thanks, it goes on to say, thanks be to God for our Lord Jesus Christ who gives us the victory. That because he died and lived, we too can die and live forevermore with him. Now, I don't know what your beliefs are, and a lot of different people here, but I can tell you this. I know this. That you would like, if you die, regardless if you feel, well, you're dead, or whatever, I'm sure that if you could be assured that when you die and you trust the Lord Jesus as Savior, that you're going to be a place where it says, and all things will be made new, and there will be no more suffering, no more pain, and all the other wonderful things that are said, that you would choose that. You might outwardly try to argue, I want that, no. But I know deep down inside you would want that which is so sweet and good. If in this life you want that, much less in eternity. And that's what we could offer you. And I trust that today, in this service, with all the scripture readings and the song, the testimony, the eulogy, and everything work together to bring you, or bring us who are alive, to the place where our sister Cynthia has given testimony that she knew the Lord Jesus as Savior. And based upon the scriptures, he that believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And that's the hope. I want her service to leave with you when you go back home during the week, days ahead, and somebody else dies. You think about this. That what she said and what can be yours. And the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Father, I ask you to take these words and use it in the lives of everyone that heard it. And again, thank you for the hope we have and that she has expressed in her eulogy. And once again, we commit the rest of this service to you as we go for the interment. I ask for direction, your guidance in this. I pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We will sing the last hymn, Amazing Grace. What a wonderful testimony to close this, and that you may be able to come and you trust the Lord Jesus. If you'd like to know more about how to be saved, please contact us. We have a services 8:30 every Sunday morning right here at the church. Or you could look at our YouTube channel for messages, Grace Bible Church Barbados, and we would like to help you. Let us sing. Stand with me as we do that.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found.
mind, but now I see. Oh, my heart.
And Somebody give God some praise.
So bless the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High.
Say unto the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High.
Give them all the glory tonight.
Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory.
Thank you.
Lord, we look to you tonight. Above the singing, God, above the music, above the songs, let your name be lifted high, Jesus. Let your name be honored, God. And we commit all that we are to you, God, everything that we do. And we reach towards you, Jesus.
I'm a child. God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. And as you speak, thank you.
shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for words of comfort that the Psalms bring to us while we are alive, and then also the comfort it gives as we think of the future, as we leave this life, and then the wonderful assurance of eternity with thee, that surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We thank you that we could come here with assurance based upon your word, Lord God, and that this assurance that we speak of from your word and our sister Cynthia had, that those of her family and friends who have come here, Lord God, would seek, if they have not yet experienced that, would be able to experience that in their lives, and to be able to have that wonderful assurance that you would lead them in this life, and then in the darkness of and the sorrows of death and whatever else, that they will find you as a comfort, and to know that beyond that, that they will dwell with you one day. And so with this wonderful assurance that we have, this body that was made of dust, to dust it remains. But one day, praise God, it will be raised incorruptible, like that of our glorious Lord Jesus, never to die anymore. So we commit this body to the ground as dust it was made of, and dust it goes back to, but one day will be raised a glorious body. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
Thank you. art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you and strengthen you.
For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness. So
happy. Let's go. Come on. Where my islanders? Can some of y'all run down here to the front real quick? I gotta know who's in the building. Where my islanders? I need y'all to run down here. Come on, let me see ya. Say it.